kind of interesting to think about what the unconscious means. And so I can give you a bit of a hint. It's partly the information that's coded in your behavior. So, for example, there are a lot of things that you can do with your body that you don't know how you do. Like, you don't know how you walk, for example, or how you ride a bike, or how you talk. You can talk, but you don't know how you talk. You just move your mouth, I know, but you get the point, right? You have no conscious apprehension whatsoever of the micro details that are necessary to allow you to move your mouth. So there's a lot of information encoded in you that you don't have conscious access to. And it's not only physiologically encoded, it's also culturally encoded, because you've been targeted and shaped by the interactions of all the people you've ever encountered. And they, in turn, by all the people they've ever encountered, including their ancestors. So you're the product of this unbelievably complex, multi-generational exchange of information that in some ways is all about how to make you acceptable to the public. And there's only certain ways you can be acceptable to the public. You know, you have to be relatively clean, for example, at least in our society. You can't be too boring, or you won't have any friends. You also can't be too exciting. You know, you can't be too violent. You can't be too empty-headed, unless you're associating with people who like to feel superior. You know, we put a lot of demands on each other in terms of what constitutes acceptability, let alone ideal. We're always telling each other about both of those. What's acceptable, what's ideal. Every interaction you have shapes you into an approximation of acceptable and ideal. And that's all encoded in you, too. It's encoded in your behavior. It's also encoded in your imagination. And that's why you can go to a movie and you can instantly identify the hero and the villain, which is, of course, the first thing you do when you go to a movie, because otherwise it can't make sense out of it. And so that encoding prior to articulation, that's all the unconscious. And that's what the psychoanalysts were interested in analyzing. Now, the cognitive neuroscientists have kind of got there too, but they're still deluded into thinking that what's in your head is information and that it's ideas. And those are sort of cold and dead things. And your head is not full of ideas and information. It's full of devils and snakes. And the psychoanalysts knew that. And by that I mean, you're alive. And so are your subcomponents. And all your little sub-personalities. They're not just ideas. They see, they think, they hear, they feel, they have aims. As you know, for example, when you get possessed by anger, the aim can be entirely destructive. I want to bring down the person I love. Half an hour later you think, what the hell was I thinking about? It's like, yeah, no kidding. Well, you weren't thinking. You're just possessed by a little sub-personality. And that's what the psychoanalysts were interested in. Sub-personalities, fantasies. Next, we go to the humanists and the existentialists. Now, they're interesting because they come at the problem of what's wrong with people from a kind of a universalist perspective. Now, for Freud, if you weren't sick, you were healthy. And that seems obvious because we think you can make a clear distinction between sick and healthy. But the existentialists, they didn't want any of that. Their hypothesis was, if you're human, you're sick. There's no way out of it. And the reason you're sick, in a sense, and unlike any other animal, is that life itself poses a paradoxical problem to you. Partly because you're so conscious and because you're self-conscious, and actually a sequence of paradoxical problems. A, how do you live when you're vulnerable and mortal? That's a rough one, because you might say, well, why should I bother at all? Or who's going to know anyways in 1,000 years or 1,000,000 years? Or why is there suffering? Or how do you go on in the face of cruelty? And those are questions that grip at people's soul and crush it. And they're not a consequence of mental illness. It's like, what, how long should it take you to recover if your whole family is wiped out in a car accident? What's healthy? Well, we don't know the answer to that. It's like, should you ever recover? Maybe if you were halfway empathic, it would just kill you. You know, a lot of times people can't recover from their grief because they're guilty. They think, how can I live when all those people close to me died, and they died unfairly? Well, that's an existential problem. And then, so there's one class, which is vulnerability and mortality. Everyone's got that staring at them. So how do you deal with that? Hard question. Second class of problems. Well, everybody's always evaluating you. Always. And you're never good enough. So what that means is that you're always in an insufficient relationship with society and history. No matter how good you get, it's not good enough. And so history itself, as well as culture, always faces you as a judge. And so that's the second category of existential problem. Then the third problem is, well, what to do about you yourself? You know, there's nature you have to contend with, and there's culture you have to contend with, and then you've got yourself, and your self-consciousness, and your deep knowledge of all the things about you that could really use some repair. And the thing about those problems is that everyone has them, and they always have them, and as far as we know, they always will. And so they're built into the condition of being human. And that's what existentialism is about. It's like, life is a paradoxical problem. Is there any possible solution to a paradoxical problem? Well, that's in some ways the question of the meaning of life. And one hint is that, well, what's the meaning of life? And one answer to that is, this is the hint, is that the meaning to life is the pattern of thought and action that you take that enables you to tolerate, at least tolerate, the conditions of life. And then maybe you could move one step beyond that if you're feeling a little optimistic and say, the meaning of life is the pattern of conception and action that enables you to welcome the conditions of life. And then you might ask yourself, well, is there such a mode of being? Given the nature of the problem that you have to contend with, is there actually a mode of being that would enable that? You could say, the vulnerability, the judgment, the insufficiency, it's worth it under these conditions. And that's the other existential question.